It's the most wonderful time of the year.
It's the most wonderful time of the year. For a lot of people, winter and December in particular brings us all closer together with family and friends. And music icon Paul Anka is helping us do just that with his new album, Songs of December. Great to see you again, Mr. Musical Icon.
Well, it's good to see you, you great survivor, you.
Thank you. Is that better than being called a legend?
Well, it's certainly better than being called Who Are You and What Happened to You.
What a delightful album. And reading the liner notes, you say it has truly been a labor of love.
What I tried to do with this album was keep it all in one beautiful, lush theme. I didn't want to get any bells and whistles and novelties and overpower the songs, which you tend to hear.
You've done Christmas albums before, but this is called a seasonal album.
Yes.
And I think somebody said on the internet, it says, it goes way back to when Dwight Eisenhower was in the White House. That was the other one you did, right?
Right, right. But I did it in, my first was 1958.
Sleigh bells ring. Are you listening?
11 songs on the album. A couple of them were written way back in 1934.
Mm-hmm.
I think Winter Wonderland,
right,
and Santa Claus is Coming to Town. Is it fair to say, Paul, that they're not writing holiday songs like they used to?
Yes, I think it's very fair. I think that the bulk of the quality of songs have been written, from my point of view, for the holiday songs. And what you have coming out now are, you know, novelties and throwing it on the wall to see if maybe they will get a standard. But you're not going to beat the people that have already laid down a foundation.
The weather outside is frightful, and the fire is so delightful. And since we've no place to go, let it snow, let it snow, just let it snow.
Besides yourself, there are, I think, two other Canadian artists who have holiday albums out, Michael Bublé and Justin Bieber.
I heard Bieber do one on The View. I heard one commercial of Michael's, and of course I'm very close to the Michael thing. I helped him in the beginning, and I'm proud of what he's done. I think Bieber is a wonderful singer, and I think he's a talented guy. I think he just has to now, you know, keep the focus and keep his integrity to see if there's any longevity there. But when you're around so long, there's kind of a newfound respect that's bestowed upon you. And now that I've hit 70, I mean, I get all of this wonderfulness, like I've run the gauntlet.
My Way, of course, popularized by Frank Sinatra. You wrote the lyrics.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of people, I guess, might not know that the actual song was a French song, right?
Yeah, Comme d'habitude. I'd heard it when I was living in France, and it was a pop rock record.
You're having my baby. What a lovely way of saying how much you love me.
How about You're Having My Baby?
What about it?
Well, the song has had quite a life. Not always in a favorable light.
Right, exactly.
It was used recently in an episode of
Glee.
Glee.
That's right.
Right?
Yeah.
Rolling Stone, I think, did a poll about some of the, can I say, worst songs
yeah,
of the 70s.
You know, it was a personal song for my wife and observation. And it really got a lot more attention when the whole women's thing got behind it. But that drove it to number one, and, you know, periodicals like Time Magazine and a lot of real substantial papers, you know, they came out and said, what the hell's going on here? We got drug problems, gangs, war, you know, leave the guy alone, it's just a song.
How about Diana?
How about her? Where is she? Keep her away.
1957. Clear this up for our listeners.
Sure.
It was widely believed Diana, with those love-struck lyrics, was written to a former babysitter, but I've heard since that's not true.
Yeah, it's not quite true. Our families knew each other. I had a younger brother and a sister. There'd been an occasion when she'd come over and probably babysit for them. The real core of the song was about a younger guy, me, and I think it was 13 or 14 maybe. She was about 4 years older. Now, I say that because back then, the 50s was a time of innocence. The parameters were different. So I couldn't get to this girl other than see her in church and follow her home, etc. She was much more sophisticated than I was. So thus I wrote, I'm so young and you're so old, because everybody was saying she's too old for you. So it's pretty simple, really.
Was it hard making that transition from the 50s teen idol, the arrival of the Beatles, of course, in the 60s? It made it hard for some singers. Sinatra, of course, Tony Bennett.
I really focused on trying to keep a solid foundation, knowing that if I had it, then I would last. So I elected to get a nightclub act and focus on my writing and get the gravitas of the kid is not only just a teen idol, but he wrote The Longest Day, he wrote Tonight Show, he can perform, blah, blah, blah. So there was an absolute effort to get out there and try to broaden my base to combat what ultimately wiped all of us off the radio. I mean, even Frank, who hated pop music. I mean, when we'd sit together in the steam room and what have you, it was Cole Porter, Irving Berlin. But when he heard Elvis Presley and all these pop songs, yuck, you know, I'd give you all these little sounds. He didn't like it. And he started turning around, you know, around the early 60s, where he started accepting the fact that he better do some different pop songs.
I'll be home for Christmas.
Paul Anka, Songs of December, and happy holidays to you. We wish you a very merry, merry Christmas.
Sing a goodbye to you. It's been so many years, but I'm here on the byway thanking you my way, because you see I'm here with you at ABC. Yes, that's me. So a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year.
Reporting for Perspective, I'm Bill Diehl, ABC News.